custom, we will sing the first two verses of hymn 56, as Stivey will help me light the first candle of Advent. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And now we will sing three times through the Trisagion. Together our collect. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light, now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
First lesson is from the book of Isaiah. The word that Isaiah, son of Amoz, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills. All the nations shall stream to it. Many peoples shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations, and shall arbitrate for many peoples. They shall beat their swords into plowshares, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. O house of Jacob, come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans. You know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. But about that day and hour, no one knows, neither the angels of heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. For as the days of Noah were, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. For as in those days before the flood they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing until the flood came and swept them all away. So too will be the coming of the Son of Man. And two will be in the field, one will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding meal together, one will be taken and one will be left. Keep awake, therefore, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. The Gospel of the Lord. Night is far gone. The day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Amen. Please be seated. There was an eclipse of the moon earlier this month. One had to be awake at 5 a.m. in Connecticut to see it. Any of you here see it? No super early risers. Well, I missed it. I didn't get up until about 6 that morning, and I live in sort of a hollow with a mountain to my west, and the moon had already sunk behind that hill before I got up. Yep, I missed it. Interestingly, though, my son Luke, who lives in Hawaii, he did see it. He saw the total eclipse that night because there are 6 hours different in our time zones. And so he was watching it around 11 p.m., and I was supposedly watching it at 5 a.m. But so interesting, really, really interesting. But sometimes we just miss events. Even events that are pretty spectacular, like an eclipse. Sometimes we just can't get there in time. Sometimes we miss that sale, darn it, or that concert, or that movie, or whatever it is. Things that we'd like to do, we'd really like to do them, but we just don't get there. And that's okay. But then, of course, in a completely different category, are the events that are very special in our lives, ones that we will not miss if we can do anything we can to make it possible to be there. We will do our utmost to try to be at important graduations, weddings, baptisms, and sadly, funerals. After all, the last time all my kids and my grandkids were together, Philip's funeral. 2019, and they haven't all been together since. What our readings in Advent say to us, from the prophets through the gospel writers and to the letter of Paul, is this: the coming once again of Christ, the desire to be with God, that event is too important for our lives, for our souls, for our very existence to miss. Why do you think it is that monks and nuns for centuries and centuries have prayed the hours, day and night, from matins to compline and then to midnight prayer? Holy women and men rise to pray for at least two reasons. One is to remember that Jesus prayed at that hour at Gethsemane, and the disciples slept. Also, of course, because because of our gospel reading today, we are exhorted to be awake, be watchful, because Christ will come again at an unexpected hour. In our Book of Common Prayer, as many of you know, those 7 monastic hours have been shortened or compressed into only 4 times to pray for us Episcopalians: morning prayer, noonday, evening prayer, and compline. And the Church, I guess, feels it's unreasonable, maybe unhealthy too, to insist that people should wake up in the middle of the night to pray. But there is a spiritual reason to be up and prayerful in the middle of the night. It's quiet. The events of the day are over. And to tell the truth, sometimes that midnight to 3 a.m. hour coincides with troubles we have sleeping. We might find ourselves awake, not by choice. Fears or pains or just too many thoughts running around our heads sometimes make it hard to sleep. So why not pray? Why not take that opportunity to pray, whatever the reason is for our wakefulness? The strange couple of verses at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, our passage from the Gospel of Matthew this morning, remind us that, you know, we would be ready for a thief. If we were told a thief is going to come at 1 a.m., we would do everything in our power. Me, a woman living alone, I'd probably hire somebody to be at my house that time of night. If I knew that there was going to be a thief, I would make a huge effort to be ready for that. So why can't we attend to being ready for the return of our God? What important things do we attend to take care of our souls? Do we make time for prayer, for scripture, for receiving the sacrament? And how can we, especially in this Advent season, do things that take care of our souls in this contemplative time of year? I know there's a lot to do to prepare for Christmas. Believe me, I know. And yet, we could remember, as Paul lives, Paul says, to live honorably as in the day. And what would that look like? For each one of us, a little different, perhaps. Making an effort not to eat or drink to excess. Perhaps taking the time to reach out to friends and relatives and let them know that we care about them. One Christmas task that some people think is just too much to do, and I understand that, but it's particularly well suited to Advent, is the writing of Christmas cards. And I don't mean the ones that are pre-signed and require just you throw it in an envelope and stick it in the mail. All the best from Heidi. Put in the envelope, stick it in the mail. But when I receive a card like that, although it's nice that the person sent me a card, and I look at it and I think, oh, but what are they doing? Where are they? What's been going on in their lives? You know, just a line or two would be so helpful. So I try, when I write my Christmas cards, which admittedly sometimes doesn't happen until after Christmas, try to think of something particular to say to each person I'm writing to. Because I think paying attention to others in our lives is really important and what Christ would call us to do during this time of Advent. Our Sunday school children took time last week to make something for people to let them know that they're cared for. Our activity last week was to make decorative votive candles. And I've given 4 out already. I've got 5 more to go. And the kids got to take a couple of them home with them too. And we've talked about how these little votive candles connect the Sunday school and thereby the whole parish to our people who are no longer able to come to church anymore. It's such a nice little thing to remember that it's not just all about us. Paul uses such great images in his letters. No wonder we read them thousands of years later. He uses metaphors that help us understand who we are at this time of year and what Christ is calling us to do. Paul asks us to take off the things which we don't need, which weigh us down spiritually, or which hurt our bodies and our souls. It might be a bad attitude, it might be bad habits that are hard to break or easy to fall back into. It might be a heaviness of heart or an insidious illness which needs to be attended to, but we put that off. Many times we find that we are carrying around baggage that weighs us down and makes our steps plodding and heavy, and harder than they have to be. Once we can identify and ask for help to put off those things that are troubling us, then we're ready to put on Christ, put on light, joy, simple things, holy habits. I'm not in any way suggesting that this is what we ought to do or we should do if we want to be good people. This is what I think we want to do because we are Christ's people. And these are what the things we want to do to draw us still closer to the one who loves us and saves us and heals us. I hope you will all be here on the 18th. December. That's when we're having our pageant. It's going to be pretty different this year because it's about a worried wise man. And his name is Melchior, one of the traditional wise men, and he is weighed down with lots of troubles. So come and find out how Melchior gets help and is able to put off the heavy burdens that he carries. He might finally be able to put on a little peace. He gets help from his camel, Nubia. And what suddenly occurred to me as I was writing this sermon was, what do camels do? Carry stuff for people. So I'm thinking that this book is sort of like the gospel according to Nubia. There was a lovely new moon last evening. Did any of you see that? Yeah, it was setting in the night sky about 5 o'clock in the western part of the sky. It was beautiful. And the calm beauty of the dawn, this morning at about 6 a.m. or so, the sky to the east was very pink because the clouds, of course, are coming in and we're going to have, I guess, rain a little bit later today. But the dawn was just so pretty. And any dawn, right before it happens, the sky is getting a little lighter, a little lighter, a little lighter. I think that is a great metaphor for Advent, as the light comes, bit by bit, slowly, slowly, and it always comes. Let us spend this Advent being watchful this year, being patient and hopeful, looking for opportunities to meet Christ in prayer, in Holy Communion, in the words of Scripture, and in the eyes of friends and strangers. Come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. stand and say together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people. Father, we pray for all peoples throughout the world, especially the people of Ukraine and all here in the U.S. who have been victims of gun violence. Grant that every member of the church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all those in religious orders, for lay and ordained ministers, and all the holy people of God.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
We give thanks at all times for the blessings of our lives. We lift up our thanksgivings. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
On our parish cycle of prayer, we pray today for Randy Orzano and Gretchen Hochmeister, for Tom Reagan, and for Biz Rogers, and for their families.
That we may serve and love them and one another as Christ loves us.
Have compassion on those who suffer, especially Eric, Zoe, Joan, Joe, Kenny, Jeremy, all cancer and dementia patients, Allie, Vicky, Cindy, Nick, Mike, Millie, Aaron, victims of social injustice, Kathleen, Sherry, Alicia, Julia, Debbie, the Dobschutz and Schindler families, Bill, Dorothy, Gwen, Maggie, Ellen and Jeremy, Rebecca, Kim and Cece, Judith and family, Gretchen and Patsy, Doreen and Lincoln, Jared, Lori, Cole, Roz, Kimberly and Joan, Brooks, Erica, Steve, Kathy, and Sarah.
Kelly, for Charles, who lies in great weakness and is suffering.
We pray for all those who have died, especially those we name. Kevin, Pam, Barb, Ida Leonard, Tom Dean, Ellen Wittlinger, Katie Gannett, and Betsy Howie. Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for all the saints, those we love in this world and in the next.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. Well, this is Advent. There's a lot going on, so please read your bulletin announcements carefully, and I hope you can attend as many of these things as possible, especially the concerts we will have here, which of course will be beautiful. I'm looking forward to those. And so Betsy Howie's funeral will be here on the 10th of December at 11 a.m., and it's going to be quite a challenge for Christine, but she wants to be here. And so she will be playing for the funeral and then racing up to Great Barrington for a concert up there. Thank you, Christine. Also, we have some nice treats that were brought to us by Beata for coffee hour. However, she isn't here. And so I could use some help in the kitchen. And so if somebody, after taking communion, would be willing to go out and set up the rest of I've set up the coffee, and I've got the sweets out there, but we need the usual accoutrement, if somebody would be willing to go out and help with that. Okay? Thank you. I didn't know if you were raising your hand. But okay. All right, so Martha and Beth, thank you. Anything else we should know about today?
The tree lighting?
Oh, yes, of course. Well, that's in there, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yes. 5 p.m.? Next Saturday, hope you'll all be here. It was fun, I guess, helping the guys put up the lights last week, and God willing, they'll light up when we plug them in. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Service continues at the top of page 5. God, source of life abundant. From before time you made ready the creation. Your spirit moved over the deep and brought all things into being, sun, moon, and stars, earth, winds, and waters, and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways. But we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forget us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so this day, we join with saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing. Jesus, the holy child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw the whole world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life and to be glorified by you. On the night before he died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now gathered at your table, O God of all creation, remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves, a living sacrifice. Pour out your spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever. people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ lives for you and feed on them in your heart by faith and thanksgiving. To himself, and the blessing of God Almighty.